Well, here we're all here now, and so I'll open this meeting. Welcome to the April 28th meeting of the Barnstable County Board of Regional Commissioners. Before I call the meeting to order, I will read the following notice. The meeting will be held through remote participation by the Board of Regional Commissioners pursuant to Massachusetts Governor Charles D. Baker's order suspending certain provisions of the open meeting law on March 12th, 2020. With that, I'll call the meeting to order and we'll stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Got a flag for us? Pledge allegiance.
To the flag.
United States
of America and to the Republic for which it stands. One nation.
Under God.
Indivisible.
With liberty. Justice.
And justice for all.
Thank you. Now we'll observe a moment of silence to honor our troops serving our country here and overseas. Thank you. And now we will move on to the approval of the minutes of April 21st, 2021. If you've had a chance to read the minutes, if there's no additions or corrections,
I'll move to approve the minutes, Mr. Chairman of the Board of Regional Commissioners, the regular meeting of April 21st, 2021.
And I will second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Take a voice vote on all votes. Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay, now on general business, we'll have our weekly update on the COVID-19 in Barnstable County. And traditionally, we start with Vera. So, Vera, are you with us?
I'm here. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Vera Herrick, Interim Director of the Barnstable County Department of Human Services. I've posted a couple of charts in the chat, and I've obviously circulated them to everyone of note. I'm sort of not going to belabor the death chart, which needs no introduction because it is at zero. We have not had fatalities for the last several days. It's wonderful news. New cases are also down in Barnstable County. The same can't be said for the islands yet. They are still still working through a relatively high level of cases, which continue to sort of refill themselves as time goes on. But here we are decidedly below where wave three started in mid to late February. In terms of new cases on a three-day basis, as you can see in the epi chart there. On Tuesday, the 27th, yesterday, the CDC updated their masking guidance to the great relief of everyone. And they put out a couple of graphical representations of if you're vaccinated, what's safe to do, both indoors and outdoors, and if you are unvaccinated, what's safe to do indoors and outdoors. I've posted two snapshots of that graphical representation, and we've been sharing it widely through our channels here in the county. Sean has sent it out to his people. Sonia has done the same. We're all sharing it. What I'm trying to do is also get this, in one consolidated chart from the CDC, which has been surprisingly difficult to do. I'm not sure why they're not sort of posting it in its entirety. But I'm trying to find that on their website, and I will supply that to all of our colleagues when I do. We definitely are moving along from a new cases point of view, and I'll step aside for now. I'm sure there's plenty of vaccination news from Sean and his colleagues.
Yes, Sean, you can take it.
Great. Thank you, Chairman Bergstrom. Good morning, everybody. For the record, Sean O'Brien, Director of Barnstable County Department of Health and Environment. We are still receiving between 3,600 and about 4,700 doses every week. Some weeks we do get an extra amount. Some weeks we go back to the almost 3,600. So we are continuing on. As we talked last week, we were doing, this is our last week of second dose clinics that we're going through. So, we did almost 1,200 doses, second doses yesterday at Cape Cod Community College. We've got another clinic today for second doses, and that's going to be about 620 doses today. Tomorrow, we're going to be out at Four Seas doing a first dose clinic for about 800 folks. And this Friday, we'll do a 400 about 450 doses out at the fairgrounds. We've been very happy with our association with the Community Health Center of Cape Cod. That has allowed us to get extra vaccine and to be able to really kind of bolster up vaccination efforts on the Upper Cape. And it's really working out well. We anticipate next week to be able to, we anticipate next week to start, getting back into the first doses. So we'll have quite a few first dose clinics over at the community college as well, or at least some during the week. We still are working. We do have some Johnson & Johnson vaccine left. We are able to use it again. We're just trying to look to see what the best location may be for starting to use some of those doses. Additionally, we continue to use the Pfizer vaccine. And just a reminder, Pfizer, basically people need to get that second dose within 21 days, so 3 weeks. And so it's like 3 weeks on, 3 weeks off. We have 3 weeks of first doses and then 3 weeks of second doses. But we've been able to continue moving forward with having first dose clinics in there as well. Our folks have done a good job making sure they're able to kind of spread that out. So I'll leave it at that. If anybody has any questions, I'm right here.
Do you have any questions for Sean? Yes, Sheila? Sheila, you're muted?
Yes, I know, I get it. I was just looking for the mute button. Sean, what's the feeling about the Johnson & Johnson at this point? Have people taken it since it's come back online, or?
We're hearing that it is taken. We have not offered a clinic yet, Commissioner Lyons, with Johnson & Johnson yet. But we hear people are taking it, and we do know that there are people that do want it because they like the idea of that one dose. But we also have, we do occasionally hear where people prefer not to have it. Right. So we're going to just make it available, and we'll figure out how to do that. It is a much easier vaccine to use because then you don't have that second clinic you have to schedule.
Right.
So it's kind of unfortunate that this had happened. But I think, I think for the most part, a lot of people are still interested in taking it.
Right. Well, I just wanted to point out, I was listening to different things, different experts speaking about it. And the one that sort of made, nobody's really putting it in that context. Birth control has a much higher risk of blood clots than does this vaccine. It has had more of an occurrence of blood clots in its lifetime out there in the public than this has had. It was their responsibility to report this one finding because that wasn't found during the test.
Sure.
But most people I know are like, just give me whatever you have. And they're being very good about it. But I did want to point that out for those who are hesitant that this is something evil or really, really, really dangerous. It's not. If women have taken birth control in their lives, they've taken more risk with that than they have.
It is my understanding, too, that even getting COVID has a higher risk of developing blood clots.
Right.
So,
And these people might have taken aspirin. I mean, there's certain aspects of this particular, thing that just didn't jive. So anyway, thank you. I was just curious if there was like a real strong feeling about it one way or another. And I'm glad to hear there isn't.
Okay. Sean, how much Johnson & Johnson do we have?
Oh, we've got about 1,400 doses.
What's keeping us from putting those out right now?
Oh, we're just discussing it internally, and we still have quite a bit of Pfizer as well. So, we'll figure out, we'll get a plan put together. We just found out on Monday, and everything we had scheduled this week was Pfizer.
Yeah, but I mean, I guess what I'm getting at is we're not able to ramp up our vaccination program to accommodate the additional doses. I mean, why can't we give out Johnson & Johnson while we're also doing the second?
We can, but the great thing about Johnson & Johnson is, Commissioner or Chairman Bergstrom, is that it's a great vaccine to use for populations that may be tough to get a second dose on. And so that's one of the things that we're discussing right now.
Okay. If there's no other questions, Sean, I don't know, Mark, you have anything? If not, we can move on to Item B, we had talked, and I know Mark had brought it up frequently about trying to get targeted populations, people who are hard to get go to, and you know, other certain ethnic communities. Have you had a chance to look into how well we're doing as far as reaching out to people who are not yet vaccinated and have certain, you know, restrictions on them, Sean?
Well, I think Erica has a presentation to give you and to talk about all of that. And let me preface everything. So Erica has been serving in the role as the operations section chief for our vaccination program.
Okay. Erica, you're on. I see a beautiful tropical background you have behind you.
I know. Don't we all wish we were there, huh? Thank you. Yes, again, my name is Erica Woods, Deputy Director for the Barnstable County Department of Health and Environment. I'm going to put up a couple of slides here. Can you see my slide?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Excellent. So what I wanted to do was just kind of give a general overview of what the whole overall plan is, and then my next slides discuss the homebound populations and other ones. So the vaccine consortium was it was established in late February, and one of the first things that we did discuss was the homebound population. But of course, at that time, we also wanted to make sure that we were able to get regional clinics so that individuals who were able to get transportation were able to get through. So at this point, we've distributed around 30,000 total doses. I won't go through all of these details, but I just wanted to make sure that you were all aware of about how many doses we've distributed, as well as Cape Cod Healthcare. Other availabilities in the area have been the health centers. We're specifically working with Outer Cape Health and Community Health Centers of Cape Cod, but there are other organizations that receive regular deliveries. And of course, we have the pharmacies who've received a good amount of vaccines throughout, as well as the Veterans Administration. I know they've been running regular clinics as well. We continue discussions with the concern for transportation-challenged individuals, especially where we have a large seasonal worker population. A lot of them use bicycles to get around. One of the things that we did was try to make sure that we had some regional locations. Again, our Little Creek DPW in Orleans, and then the fairgrounds, just to try to make it at least a little closer for people. Outer Cape Health and Community Health Centers of Cape Cod are working with towns to identify individuals. And I'll get a little bit more into that on the next slide. Another thing that we did do with the consortium is specifically reach out to some of those target populations. Early on in the process, the first responders were among the first that were getting vaccinations, and most of the ones that we ran were out of the DPW in Orleans, but we specifically reached out to individuals to assess interest, and in some situations basically pre-register people, especially for the service industry, etc., so that they had again, you guys heard about our issues with PrepMod and how hard it was for people to register for those clinics. We really wanted to make sure that we were able to reach the target population. Same thing with Cape Cod Healthcare. A lot of the pre-registration lists and such lists we sent to them because early on in the process, they did not have a way to register people. So they would public registration system, I guess. Right now they do have a link where you can click on and get registered, but prior to this week they didn't. So basically what the commission, the consortium was doing was sending them lists of people that we had identified as wanting the vaccine, as being eligible in that current phase, and they would reach out to them, make appointments, and get them through either the Melody Tent or Cape Cod Community College. So that's just kind of a quick overview. I didn't want to get too bogged down in that. But so the homebound populations, as I mentioned, that was one of the earlier on in the process, one of the first populations that we identified as a concern. And so that was basically up to the community health centers for the most part on the mid, lower, and outer Cape. Outer Cape Healthcare worked directly with the towns. In some cases, the EMS went out and assisted with the distribution. A lot of times it was a nurse and an ambulance. They would go give the vaccine. Of course, there's the 15 or 30 minute observation time. So a clinical individual would stay with that in, that person until they were very comfortable that they were all set, and then kind of hopscotched through the rest of them. So that process, as you can see by this chart, which was provided by Pat Nadel of Outer Cape Health Services, Yarmouth, there still remains some to be vaccinated. But in Dennis, there still remains to be some vaccinated, but the other towns pretty much are done. However, Outer Cape Health Services is still in contact with the town so that if they do identify other individuals that need assistance, they'll set it up and get that taken care of. A lot of times people can call either their local health department or Council on Aging to get on a list, and they will contact the regional entity that is helping with the homebound population. So again, the VNA is part of this, Outer Cape Health Services, and emergency medical services from each of the towns. For the other areas of the Cape, it's a little bit different, and some towns have a fairly strong public health nursing department where others do not. Falmouth, you could see that. So Cape Cod Health, Community Health Centers of Cape Cod helped with the homebound vaccinations. And again, with the community health centers, the advantage to that is that they're not using our allotment of vaccine. They get their vaccines directly from the federal government. So they were early on in the process, they weren't getting very many vaccines, but they were getting enough to reach out to these populations. So, and again, as you'll see, you know, Falmouth continues to connect with the homebound, connect the homebound with community health centers. The email that I got says that they still get between 1 and 15 individuals a week that are identified and that they bring in and take care of. Mashpee, fairly similar. Their EMS was heavily involved in that distribution, but worked with community health centers. Bourne, that again was you know, another outcropping. So, you know, the health department, fire department, councils on aging, all helped to identify that homebound population and connect them. And then Sandwich is working with their own EMS. They have a town nurse and they are distributing the vaccine within that town. So currently the consortium is, you know, still trying to identify other populations that might need a little extra support in getting the vaccines out to them. And we're basically looking at the different entities that are part of the consortium in order to identify the best ones to respond to specific situations. And, you know, as an example, transportation, Steamship Authority, Community Health Centers of Cape Cod is nearest to Falmouth. They have the extra vaccine. They helped us out with that. Whereas, you know, Cape Cod Healthcare has done some other similar type pop-ups. We have done some similar type pop-ups, as well as the Outer Cape Health Services. So, you know, again, basically we continue to meet on a regular basis so that we can identify kind of where the holes are, where we need to reach out, and then target those populations. And then, you know, just back to that, the question about how many doses of Johnson & Johnson we have, what we're trying to do is, because we don't get a regular allotment of Johnson & Johnson, that's one of the most limited availability, available vaccines. So we're trying to target the populations that we might, that might be best used for. I mean, we could certainly do an open population clinic and use them up, but especially with the homebounds, it's a lot of effort for everyone to do those. So it's good to have that single dose. Some of the special populations, the hesitant populations, we want to try to target those. I went through that kind of quickly, so I didn't want to take up too much of your time. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to field them.
Anybody, either my fellow commissioners have any questions, Erica? Okay.
I just wanted to say to people that if they're really interested, the Globe does have a good, online website about by town, how many vaccinations have been given out and what percentage they're at. And I know the Outer Cape is, we're a small town, so it's easy to hit, 80%, 90%, but before everybody else. But it's an interesting, a lot of interesting stuff there. But I want to thank all of you. I think this has been an incredible effort. And I think between the one shot, the two shots, you're probably more than two thirds of the way there. So
we're definitely getting there.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Real team effort between local boards of health, councils on aging, the various medical facilities like Outer Cape. I mean, it's amazing that we've been able to marshal our resources.
I do have a question while we have everybody on this topic. So we have the summer influx coming, and that's going to create a whole other thing, and hopefully most of these people coming are going to be vaccinated before they get here. I was speaking to a real estate agent who only deals with rentals, rental cottages, inns, and motels. And she said that there is nothing available from May through the end of August or into September. So it is going to be, the predictions are it's going to be a busy season. I believe it is. Do we have any, are there any discussions and thinking about the what ifs with that many people here and what may happen? As I say, hopefully, but I, and if we haven't, I think it's just something everybody should think about, like what could be the worst case scenarios of all of these people coming here, and how would we respond if there was another outbreak or something like that?
I think, the good news is that we're in a better position than we were last summer, as far as the availability of testing. We have the ability to continue PCR testing. Cape Cod Healthcare, again, last summer there were still limitations on that. The fact that we have the vaccines out there, we will continue, and all of the organizations will continue to distribute those. And we're absolutely in conversations as far as trying to make sure that we reach those seasonal populations, whether they're seasonal workers or seasonal residents. Although at the same time, a lot of the seasonal residents have probably been here for the past year because they've been working remotely. That's true. But still, we're definitely in discussions on those, and continuing to get that messaging out there that it's not over. It's not over just because the vaccines are out there.
I think you'll still see, there will be clinics, there will be places available to get that vaccine. It may be scaled back a little bit, depending upon demand and everything. But those are things that we're going, that we're talking about discussions now. As long as vaccine is coming in, we want to make sure it's available to the people.
Okay. Thank you. I see Beth has.
The follow up on what Sheila said, I'm worried that we're still going to be, restaurants and so on and other venues are still going to be under restrictions at least till August 1st, I understand from the governor. It's going to, the population, as Sheila said, is going to be boom here. It looks like we're going to have a ton of people on the Cape. It'd be very difficult for the local boards of health and the fire departments and, to police the kind of restrictions that are put into place. We thought about that. I know at one point we had county people helping, but anybody given an idea of what they're going to do?
Ron, I see Beth has her hand up.
I do. I have actually a comment. So, but if they want to respond to Ron's question.
Sure. It has been kind of batted around. We're still providing summer inspectors again this year. We've kind of batted it around. There was some discussion. If this is a direction the commissioners would like to move again with some additional inspectors to help out, the towns have asked. We had some early discussions. So if it's something that that the commissioners are interested in helping with, I think it's something that we can help the towns out with. We've only really had inquiries from a couple of towns about it again. We did not see all towns use it last year. Some towns opted not to. But I think all in all, it helped the towns that used those three inspectors quite a bit. So, you know, it's an option we can move forward with. Like I said, we've had maybe two towns ask. I don't know, Erica, if you've seen any more, but I think we saw maybe two towns request.
Yeah, there's a couple of towns, and I think a couple more would definitely be interested.
Okay. All right, Beth, you had a question or a comment?
Yeah, just a comment. In the Cape Cod Times this morning, there was a big article about vaccination, and they mentioned Harbor Health and the vaccination clinic that they're running at the Town of Barnstable Adult Community Center. It appeared from the article, and I just wanted to know that it was a drop-in clinic, that there were that you didn't have to make a schedule an appointment, and I didn't know if that was, wanted to make sure that was accurate.
I'm not quite sure, Beth. I'll have to follow up on it, but I know, for a lot of folks, they are able to do walk-ins. They may be able to do walk-ins. It's a matter of the type of software they're using for patient registration. So sometimes they're used to a heavy front end, so to speak, with a data collection and everything else. So we'll find out. But my guess is it's probably the case.
Okay. Vera, did you have a question or a comment?
Yes, thank you. To your point that was being raised about towns needing help or the preparations being made for the summer season, we have a directly analogous experience of last summer. At this time, preparations were underway. And then once people arrived, everything was booked up.
Right.
We had a successful summer season with very low case counts. And I can tell you that, and several of us on this call are also on the task force that is actively discussing this at this time as well. So those, Commissioner Lyons, to your question, those preparations are well underway, and we have last summer's experience to rely upon to navigate this successfully. We're well ahead of the game.
Great. Thank you. Thank you all.
We have nothing else on this. I thank you for Vera and Erica and Sean, and keep up the good work.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Before we move on, I neglected to request public comment, so I'll read this notice right now. All public comments or questions should be directed to Beth Albert, County Administrator at BALBERT@BarnstableCounty.org. The board will not respond to public comment and will not endorse any position taken by the author of public comment unless it determines the matter needs to be addressed at a future board meeting. The board will post any such comment on the agenda at the discretion of the chair. Okay, I'm sorry, I passed that over. Okay, moving on now, we have item C on wildfire training. Phil Burke, the Director of Public Safety, is with us. Phil?
Good morning, commissioners. Yes, Phil Burt, Barnstable County, and joining me is Andrew Platt. He's a deputy director of the department. I really just wanted to go over a couple things, give a little update on a program that we're in the infancy stages sort of getting going, really tying back to last summer because the county made a fairly sizable investment last summer in some training equipment and some land management equipment relative to wildfire. And Andrew and I have been working to get a program up and running so that equipment doesn't just sort of sit around and collect dust, because that's ultimately the goal, is to get this stuff out into the field. And we're trying to come up with some good plans to do that. So I'm just going to walk through a lot of this stuff is information you already know. It's really just a sort of a, like I said, an update to give you a sense of where we're going. So I'll kind of go through a handful of background things, and then Andrew's going to talk a little bit more about specifics on some of the programs. So as the slide references here, this is really an idea that had some genesis probably 15 years ago, 20 years ago, through the county. Barnstable County had started through the Cape Cod Cooperative Extension doing wildfire planning work across the Cape. So they had hired a series of contractors who went out across Cape Cod and looked at high-risk parcels, generally large tracts of open space, areas that might be historically susceptible to wildfire, and put together some really good, solid plans with the idea that those plans could then be implemented to do mitigation work to keep wildfire at bay. So it really, it fills a really good county goal of doing regional work. It's not necessarily an issue that any one particular community can tackle on its own, so it's a good niche for the county to fill. And so when Andrew and I kind of got into the discussions about moving forward with this again, I think one of our big things was coming up with a program that would be sustainable, that would keep going year in, year out, that we could kind of come up with a way to take what we have for existing resources on the Cape and really put together a program that year in, year out is targeting high-risk areas and doing mitigation work to avoid a large-scale event, which you'll see on the next slide is there is some historic precedent for this. Well, I think a lot of people don't. We've talked about this before in commissioners' meetings, and I know that the extension has brought this up in the past. I think, you know, people don't think of Cape Cod as an area that's susceptible to it, but it most certainly is. There's a long standing history of it, of some very substantial fires going back into the early part of the 1900s through the mid 19, like right around up to 1950. This photo here, I think, is 1946. Very large fires, though, thousands of acres, fires that jumped roads and infiltrated neighborhoods. And a lot of that's due to the vegetation and the soil makeup of Cape Cod. And so, you know, a lot of that stuff, you know, those are things that only slowly change over hundreds of years, not over, you know, not over decades. So pitch pine forest will probably very slowly go away on Cape Cod as more mature forests develop. But, you know, for now, that's what a lot of the Cape is, especially the outer part of the Cape, very sandy soils. And then in recent years, several years in a row of winter moth and gypsy moth caterpillar infiltration has left large strands of dead trees. So, I mean, there's a lot of places you can drive around the Cape, especially again out in the seashore. But even where I live in Brewster, there's several areas where you drive around and you just see a lot of dead oak trees. Multiple years of the leaf out being destroyed by those caterpillars, and the tree just can't handle it year in, year out. And usually they can survive 1 or 2 years, but if it happens multiple years in a row, the tree dies, and we see large strands of, so we've got a lot of areas of basically tinder of mm-hmm. dead trees. And of course the Cape has a lot of open space. You know, as the numbers referenced there, Cape Cod National Seashore, over 43,000 acres, Joint Base Cape Cod, 22,000 acres, and plenty of parcels of land that the towns own or owned by conservation trusts that are, hundreds of acres, thousands of acres in size. So a lot of open space that needs consistent management to keep wildfire at bay. And then what brought this whole thing back up was a member of the previous Board of Commissioners had approached us last summer and said, hey, with the ongoing drought, what is the county doing to address this? And maybe we should look into revamping some of our program. And so we are now kind of in a strange situation with a drought. There's some neat pictures out there. You can actually go onto YouTube and you can look up some of these fires. There's some great video that's actually been redone and colorized, and fantastic video from fires that happened on the upper part of Cape Cod, most of them. And that actually there, that unit there is actually a Barnstable County forest fire control unit. So that's kind of neat, some history there. And another picture of one of these large fires that happened on the upper part of the Cape. So with respect to the rainfall, if you look, you look at Cape Cod, you look at New England generally, you know, long-term drought is not going to be a thing that we're ever really going to have to worry about. We're never going to go. We're not California in that sense. We're not going to have year after year after year of absolutely no rainfall. That's not the way our climate works here. But We can definitely get into stretches where we don't have very much rain. And what's interesting about the last couple of years is, and it may tie, who knows, maybe this ties a little bit into long-term climate change. So as these boxes sort of appear here, so 2020, this data here is from Hyannis. So long-term average, about 48 inches of rain and snow over the course of a year. 2020, substantially less, only about 33 inches of precipitation was recorded total. So that includes snow melt, way below what we would normally see. But interestingly enough, that was 2020. It was preceded by 17, 18, and 19 of having three out of the four most or highest precipitation totals we've ever seen in this area. So maybe that's a look at how things will go. And this kind of fits in with the narrative of climate change, which is extremes. Maybe that's the way this is going to play out, was we will have years of substantially lower precipitation. And then it's interesting because 2016 would be the second lowest. So the highest and the lowest have all happened in the last handful of years here. But we were way below what we would normally see. And a lot of that really hit during the summertime. Last summer was the particular, and you'll see on the next slide where that was. So, everyone around the Cape saw it, long term. June, July, and August are always our wet months on the Cape. Are always our dry months on the Cape. But we usually do see some rainfall. And last year we just had such minimal amounts in total there for June, July, and August. And Hyannis was 3.29 inches. There were places on parts of the Cape that only had around 2 inches of precipitation for the entire summer. It was very dry. And for the first time, it's not uncommon for the Cape to end up with, brown lawns and that kind of thing during the summer. That's not unusual at all. But it is uncommon to start to see wilted vegetation, which there actually was some. There were plenty of plants where the leaves, especially the undergrowth in forests, where those shallow rooted plants were starting to, you saw the leaves actually starting to wilt a little bit, which is, that's mm-hmm. unusual for the Cape. And so I kind of kept track of that during, throughout last year, as we moved into this program, and thought, one of the things that the long-term weather pattern wasn't looking particularly wet, and sure enough, it hasn't been particularly wet since then. So here's where we stand so far in 2021, despite the, little trickle of rain we had last night. Hyannis, again, this is all based on Hyannis data. It's a little bit different throughout the Cape, but long-term average through the date, we should have close to 17 inches of rain or snow melt. We've had 10.5 inches. So you add that into last year, so we're now significantly, so last year we were, say, call it 15 inches behind where we should be, where we should have been. Compounded, now we're about 6 inches behind where we should be this year. So it is continuing. Ultimately, I suspect that we will climb out of this. Like I said, New England, we don't head into long lasting drought conditions, but we're certainly well into one right now.
Yeah.
And if you fast forward into the summertime, our dry months are coming. So we really do look for March, April, and then sometimes May to be our months where we catch up. And so far, we really haven't. There are some signs that maybe in the next handful of weeks, we'll get a handful more rainfall events, but I can't imagine we're going to dent, what is a 15 to 20 inch deficit at this point. And you're starting to see towns address that with water restrictions. And if you're an outdoors person, you'll see there's areas around the Cape right now where there's like vernal pools that have no water in them, that usually would typically have water in them in the summer. So, or in the spring, my apologies. So bringing this back. So last year, the county commissioners and the Assembly of Delegates approved the purchase of a wildfire mitigation trailer. This was happened in sort of serendipitous timing. As we were discussing this, this became available. So the gentleman who owned this had a company that was mainly the main source for doing prescribed burns on Cape Cod and in southeastern Massachusetts. He took a job as the fire management officer out at JBCC and had to close his company, and had just purchased all of this brand new equipment for his company. So, and he was really interested to see that stay on Cape Cod. So he approached the county about taking that equipment. So when Andrew and I kind of got into discussions about this with Jack and with the commissioners and so on, we're trying to come up with a program that could utilize this equipment, utilize training. This is what we do in our department, and come up with a way to make this a good county resource and a good county asset. because the stuff that's in there, I mean, it is a land management tool. It's a training tool. It's a response tool, technically. I mean, if you there's enough there, if there was a wildfire, towns could access that equipment and use it to put out. And it's also, as I think the second to last bullet point there mentions, it's an opportunity to revamp some programs that the counties had historically that were really good programs that we'd like to see moving forward. So I'm going to hand it off to Andrew, and he's going to talk a little bit about the specifics of where we're going, and then we'll just open it up if you guys have any questions.
Yeah. All right. Good morning, commissioners. My name is Andrew Platt. I'm the deputy director for public safety training. I originally came to the Cape as an AmeriCorps member many years ago and actually served in the Fire Corps program. So this is an issue that's kind of close to my heart. Spent a lot of time out at the seashore doing prescribed burns and working with the wildland fire community. So, you know, it really the crux of what we're able to do with this, I think the first and foremost comes to training. Wildland firefighting is a very different style of firefighting from typical structural firefighting. You know, you're in the woods, you're away from the truck. The tactics are quite different. You don't do a lot of direct attack. You do a lot of fighting fire with fire. You don't use a lot of water. You build line. You actually light fires to try to burn out fuels ahead of a wildfire. And then you can use these resources as a land management tool to actually reduce fuels in an area through prescribed burning to prevent fires in the future, but also to act as brakes if there is a fire, so giving firefighters a better chance to fight those fires. So, you know, really what we would look at doing in the interim is working with the Massachusetts Department of Conservation and Recreation Forest Fire Control, the fire warden, in kind of assisting them with their S-130-190 basic wildland firefighting training. This is typically a pretty intense training. It normally takes about a week to do, a lot of field training, a lot of prescribed burning, a lot of classroom time. But we've been working with them and hopefully using this trailer and this equipment to make it in a way that's a little more conducive to our structural fire departments here on Cape, being able to get their folks out to take this training. It's normally difficult to for a firefighter here on Cape to either take a week off or for a department to pay overtime for a week for one of their firefighters to go and take this training. So we've really looked at kind of revamping it into something that has an online component that covers a lot of the grounds of the training, and then reducing it down to a single 8-hour classroom session, and then having a six-month window for those folks to do a field session with our equipment, going out and doing a prescribed burn. So they have 6 months to join a prescribed burn as a trainee here on the Cape. Burning happens, you know, pretty regularly here on the Cape. The Cape Cod National Seashore does a lot of prescribed burning. Joint Base Cape Cod does a lot of prescribed burns to try to manage their land. And, you know, we're hoping we're able to relaunch some of the county's initiatives to bring wildfire management and those land management techniques to some of the towns as well, especially in the absence of Northeast Forest Fire Management, as Phil mentioned, no longer existing. So this is really kind of our first step in getting more of our structural fire departments and more of our firefighters here on Cape trained in wildland fire tactics. You know, I think our structural fire departments are the first ones to respond to brush fires. They handle brush fires every season, and a small brush fire you might be able to handle, you know, off the side of a truck. But the second you have to start walking out into the woods and putting out progressive hose lay and dealing with a fire kind of away from a truck, it starts to the tactics really change pretty significantly. So that training is very important. You know, as Phil mentioned in the past, we've had a pretty good partnership across town, county, state, federal. He mentioned the Barnstable County Wildfire Preparedness Plan. That really laid out a lot of this this groundwork for these relationships. You see this Forest Fire Control District 1, Joint Base Cape Cod, the National Seashore, AmeriCorps, as I mentioned, and I'll talk about in a second. Town fire departments, their natural resource departments, and local land trusts and conservation trusts. I can go on for hours about it, but fire is a natural process. It is something that it's the forest's way of managing itself in a lot of ways. The Cape historically used to burn, you know, every 50 to 60 years prior to it being settled and developed. And that really helped manage the forest. It kept things like pitch pine at bay, and we had an open heathland environment here. A lot of our native species here actually thrive in a fire environment. And without that fire burning through the area, a lot more invasive plants have been able to grow up. You've seen pitch pine take over in a lot of areas, some rather unhealthy forests with a lot of fuel. And you've seen the loss of animals like the New England cottontail and quail. Their numbers have been significantly reduced because a lot of their natural environment, which is a kind of an open heathland or savanna environment, has disappeared, especially out on the seashore as pitch pine's kind of taken over. So it is actually a conservation tool as well, which is very important. That wildfire preparedness plan actually goes through town by town. You can actually see, I happen to choose Chatham, Yarmouth, and Wellfleet at random, kind of displaying some of the fire danger. That plan actually lays out different areas of fire danger and proposed mitigation areas. And this is actually what spawned the Fire Corps program that AmeriCorps used to run. I think this is something that, as the AmeriCorps program looks forward, I think it's something that they've done for a long time. The specific Fire Corps program that spawned out of this plan, I was a part of it. I know it brought a lot of members here. It did a lot of really great work and great service going out and doing prescribed burns, both at the seashore and for the towns, doing a lot of fuel reduction. I mentioned that kind of natural resource management and heathland restoration. And I think we can use this equipment in conjunction with the AmeriCorps program to really restart a lot of their wildfire mitigation program and get out there and continue to do this work. We're actually going to have the members this year go out in a couple weeks and do the S-130-190 training that I just mentioned as kind of guinea pigs for us and see if we can kind of bring it back into the program and be available for those prescribed burns. So they'll be using our equipment in a couple weeks to go through that training and they'll be able to join in on prescribed burns and fuel reduction activities for the remainder of their time here. And then it's something we can integrate into the program going forward. I think it's a very important part of the program. And I also mentioned they've done a lot of work with the Lombard Paradise Hollow Fire Management Research Area. That's a really cool project that's been going out at the seashore for a long time in conjunction with UMass. They're actually testing a bunch of 1/10 acre plots out in Truro with different kind of fire and land management techniques out on the seashore to see what the effects of those different techniques are, what the effect of wildfire is, what the effect of chainsaw cutting and brush clearing or just leaving an area to grow by itself. And they're actually able to figure out, what are the best types of land management, what are the best strategies for kind of managing our forests out here on Cape Cod. And that's been going on since 1986. So I myself took part in helping manage those. It's a really cool project that if you go on the Seashore's website, you can learn more about, but AmeriCorps has a history with that as well. So I think this is another area that, we're pushing to try to get the AmeriCorps program involved with again, and I think they have a lot of fun with. So I'll certainly share some pictures probably after that training in a couple weeks. And see their feedback from that. So those are really a lot of the things. I ran through those pretty quickly. I don't want to take up too much of your time, but those are some of the initiatives that we're working on. I can talk about wildfire forever, so I'm happy to answer any questions, and Phil is as well, kind of regarding these initiatives and these programs that we're looking to do.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions for either Phil Bird or Andrew Platt on this subject?
No, I'd just like to make a comment as a person who lives right there in one of those maps, as we all did. It was very good of you, Andrew, to pick our towns. But and you can see that Wellfleet is really there in the middle of woods, and as am I. So I am very attuned. Last summer, I was very nervous about the drought. And you look at California and the various, the western states of what's happening there. This is, scary stuff. So I am very happy to hear that we are focusing some of our attention on this. And I also am totally behind doing whatever we can to beef up that AmeriCorps program and get more volunteers and young people learning how to do this, because unfortunately it might be fun for them now, but if they were doing this, all year long, out there in the Midwest, which I'm aware some people are doing, which used to be just a seasonal thing, they would really appreciate what they're learning more than maybe what they're probably getting right now. But anyway, thank you for that, and I feel a little more assured that we're doing something. on that front.
Okay. Welcome. Thank you.
Thank you for everything.
Anything from Mark or anybody else?
No, I just echo the comments that Sheila made. Very important program. I think if you've been involved in government on the Cape for any extended period of time, we've sort of taken fire management sort of for granted, but it's an important part of the sort of the array of services that are available here. We just tend to overlook it quite frequently. And I'm just glad we're still engaged. I like the idea of getting more AmeriCorps engagement in it. I think with a different Congress now and a different administration, I think those opportunities are actually going to emerge in the near future. And I think it's smart. It's smart management to be thinking about ways in which we can take advantage of some of the changing the changing climate and some of these new opportunities that are arising. So I appreciate the presentation, all the work that you guys are doing, and look forward to being even more supportive as you aggressively, move this initiative along.
Okay. Mike McGuire has his hand up. Mike, you have a comment?
I do. Mike McGuire, Director of Cape Cod Cooperative Extension. Phil and I talked about this, well, we've talked about it many times and talked about this extensively yesterday. So the wildfire plans that we have in place are great. They do need to be updated. We've been pursuing grant funding to update them. And recently, we're turned down for a grant proposal. If we can't get another one out the door, say in the next 6 months to the year, I may be coming to the county to look for some funding to update the existing plans. But I did, I wanted to make sure you knew that there was cross-department collaboration occurring. And additionally, there, I've talked with our horticulturalist, and the drought that we've seen will have an impact on our forest. And as Phil mentioned, it takes a long time to see some of these changes, but the drought, our last year's drought will have killed some trees. We just haven't seen that yet. So.
Okay, thank you. I remember as a newly elected selectman many years ago, 20 years ago, someone came in front of us, and I apologize, I don't remember who it was, and said, oh yes, we're talking about our fire management at the county. And I looked at them like, fire management? Isn't that something that goes on in California? And they made me immediately aware of this issue, which is sort of sits in the background until it comes up and becomes necessary. So I'm really appreciative of the efforts the county is making on this, because even though we've been lucky so far, the potential for real problems can arise very quickly, and it's good to know that we're ready to respond. If there's nothing further on that, we have item D, which is to authorize a letter from Barnstable County to the United States Coast Guard. I don't have the letter in front of me. Is this something that we're going to write up? Or Mark, do you know anything about this?
Yeah, it's there.
Yeah, there was a draft circulated last week. And, yes. So yes. I'm sorry that you don't have it. I think it was in the packets and also circulated by email. So I'm happy to speak to the urgency of the issue, but I think it's pretty well, we all talked about it at our last meeting.
Right.
I think it's pretty much understood. So I'm just looking for a vote of support for sending this letter to the Coast Guard in support of the station in Chatham and having
a full. I read the letter, and I think it's fine, and you have my support on that letter.
Yes, right. You certainly have my support, being living in Chatham and understanding the battle that Chatham has had trying to keep that Coast Guard station fully That's operational great. Over many years. And I know that Mark, when he worked for Congressman Delahunt and Studs, was an integral part of maintaining that as a viable station. And I appreciate that. And we're going to have to continue. Apparently, we're going to have to continue this battle every time it pops up. But
I think, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the history and the comments. I think it's like every 10, 15 years, the Coast Guard kind of, for whatever reason, just gets sort of misdirected when it comes to Station Chatham. And usually they end up doing the right thing. But we have to make some noise on this one. So I would like to move to authorize the signing of the letter from the county commissioners, which you have in your packets, to the United States Coast Guard in response to the removal of the surf vessels at Station Chatham.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and second. I'll call for a vote. Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
And I, chair votes aye. And I say removing a surf boat from Chatham, which probably has the harbor with the most surf anywhere on Cape Cod, is probably very short-sighted, I think. Okay, we're moving now on to an ordinance. I have two items which are absolutely identical. Item E and H, I wonder if they got on there by mistake. Elizabeth, do you know anything about this? Or Beth? Or Robin? I presume, unless I'm reading it wrong, we can skip over item E and cover F, G, and H, which are ordinances coming back to us. This is the budget ordinances, which we sent to the assembly. We approved them. They sent to the assembly. Now it's coming back for our signature. So.
So, Mr. Chairman, I'm happy to make a motion on ordinance 21-07, if you're willing to take one.
I will second.
All right. So I'd like to move to approve ordinance 21-07 to authorize the county to purchase capital equipment and implement capital improvements for use in conducting the business of the county and to borrow money to pay therefor. So you get your motions. Sheila seconds.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I'm just trying to get the numbers here, whether we don't, I guess we can always fudge them later, but okay. Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Okay. Moving on to 2108.
2108. I'd like to move that we approve ordinance 21-08 to make appropriations for the Cape Cod Commission operating budget for fiscal year 2022. For operations and capital requirements and for reserve funds.
I will second.
Okay, we move the second. Any further comment? Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
Lyons?
Aye.
And chair votes aye. And finally, on the 21-9.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to move to approve ordinance 21-09 to make appropriations for Barnstable County's operating budget for fiscal year 2022. Including the operations of the county assembly, the executive branch, county agencies, boards, commissions, departments, and institutions, and the maintenance of certain county functions for interest, reserve funds, and serial bond requirements of the county.
Do I have a second?
I will second.
Okay, been moved and seconded. We'll go with Sheila Lyons first. Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
First.
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Okay, now the last one is ordinance 21-10.
I'm happy to move that one if you'd like a motion.
Sure.
I'd like to move to approve ordinance 21-10 to amend a portion of ordinance 16-07 adopted by a vote of the Assembly of Delegates on May 4th, 2016 and approved by the Board of Regional Commissioners on May 11th, 2016 by deleting the phrase, quote, second district roof, end quote, in section 1C of ordinance 16-07 and inserting in its place, quote, repairs at the old jail complex, end quote. Such the amended vote reads in its entirety as follows, to authorize the county to purchase capital equipment and implement capital improvements for use in conducting the business of the county and to borrow money to pay therefor.
Okay, do I have a second?
I will second.
Okay, move to second. Elizabeth, this is just switching the purpose of this money from one place to another. Is that where
Correct.
We are? Okay. Yes. All right, in that case, I will take a vote. Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay, that concludes general business. Now we move on to new business. I have no new business to bring before the board. I hear nothing from my fellow commissioners.
I do. Wait.
Oh, okay.
I just want to make note, and people should look at our website and for other announcements. There was a press release yesterday that the Human Rights Commission is holding a forum presentation on what is, and it's being presented by the Attorney General's office, what defines a hate crime. I think this is something for not just the public, but for our, law enforcement and people who, even the
know, national seashore security and that sort of thing, should probably try to chime in on, at least have somebody in their staff to listen to what is that so that we understand. And I see that Beth has her hand up. She may have more to say about this, or if Susan is on it, she has more to say about it. And there is also a letter of support being sent in support of changing the name of Race Point Beach to Michaun Point in honor of the original Native American village that inhabited that area. And the Human Rights Commission is writing a letter of support. We may want to take a look at that and discuss our feelings on it as well. And there is also a report on the homeless count in Constable County that I think somewhere should be highlighted, and what are we doing? If not today, I'm mentioning it so that it can be on future discussions, but Beth may have something to shed on all of these topics. But I just want to bring them up for the public's information, and they can find more information about this on our website and on the Human Rights Commission website.
Chair Bergstrom, can we go back to E, Ordinance 2106, please? Is that possible?
Sure.
So I just took a quick look at the attachments. In 26, Ordinance 2106 does have to be voted on. Ordinance 2109, actually, what is in the on the meeting agenda appears to have improper language attached to it. So I'm not sure how you want to handle that.
Three times, like
2106 is the appropriations for the operating budget. 2109 is funding for the dredge. Elizabeth, do you?
Yeah, I just took a look too. Agreed. The 2106 is the general fund operating budget, does need to be voted, and 2109 would apparently need to be amended to read dredge.
I have on my agenda, which was sent to me, well, actually, I don't know when it was sent, but I just, it has identical. On my agenda, E and H are identical. Do you guys have a different agenda, Mark, Sean?
Mark? No, we have.
No, E and H have identical language. It was an error, it appears. So yes, in looking at this, it's 2106 is the appropriations that is for the budget, for the fiscal 22 budget. Okay. 2109 are funds for the dredge. And I apologize for this confusion.
Well, it's no problem. It's just that I need to, we can't take a motion on it unless we have the language in front of us. And
right.
If you have the language, and one of my commissioners can read it.
Yes.
Meeting.
For H, all we would have to say is Ordinance 2109 to make appropriations for the Barnstable County's dredging program for fiscal 2022, including the operations of the, well, then it goes into other things.
What I'm saying is that we passed 7, 8, and 9. If we want, and we did not pass 6. If we want to do Ordinance 6 as the dredge appropriation, we can do that.
Let me be clear. 2106, 2109.
Oh, that's right.
Is the dredge.
2109 needs to add language about adopting an operating budget for the dredge enterprise fund. So we need to amend that vote. And then if you go back, you do need to vote on 2106 with the language that's in the agenda.
Okay, so Ordinance 2109, I just received from Robin, adopting an operating budget for the Dredge Enterprise Fund for fiscal year 2022, beginning July 2021 and ending in July 30th, 2022. June 30th.
Okay.
2022.
Okay, do I have a second on that?
Yes.
Okay.
And then you
read it again. Just so because I kind of screwed up the dates. Ordinance, we're making a motion to pass Ordinance 2109, adopting an operating budget for the Dredge Enterprise Fund for the fiscal year 2022, beginning July 2021 No, yes, 2021 and ending June 30th, 2022.
Correct.
Okay, and I have a second on that already from Mark. I'll call for a vote. Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Now we have to go back to 2106. And you have to read that. Now, I don't know, we already passed it.
Okay, but I have new language on it.
Yes. Okay, good.
Ordinance 21. Beth, do you want to say something before I read this off?
No, I think what's in your agenda for 2106 is correct. Item E.
Well, I did just receive this. Yes. So 2106, to make appropriations for Barnstable County's operating budget for fiscal year 2022, including the operations of the County Assembly, Executive Branch, County Agencies, Boards, Commissions, Departments, and Institutions, and the maintenance of certain county functions for interest reserve funds and serial bond requirements of the county.
I'll second that motion.
Motion is moved and seconded. I'll call for a vote on that. Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Now, we already had passed that as ordinance 2106. I don't know how to clean that up, so we're going to have to look at that.
No, I don't believe we did. We did not take up 2106. We skipped over.
We didn't, but we passed ordinance 2109 with the same language in it.
I just read off 2106.
Okay.
That's what we just voted on, was the 2106 with the proper language.
Can you read? I apologize for the confusion. You did just vote on the amendment to 2109, including the language on the dredge. So you're good.
So that was amended. Okay, then.
Yeah.
All right. And we got through that. We now go on to commissioners' actions. I need some motions here on A.
Well, I'm happy to move the entire group if that's the desire of the board.
Yep.
If that's the case, I'd like to move that we approve items 8A through 8E as listed on the agenda for the Barnstable County Board of Regional Commissioners regular meeting on April 28th, 2021.
And I will second.
Okay, it's been moved seconded. The vote, Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. I don't mean to give short shrift to all the people who have stepped forward to be on these committees, but we appreciate everyone who comes to help.
I just want to say, I think it's an impressive group on many of them. I second your feelings on that, Ron. Thank you for stepping up and serving and giving your.
As is our custom, we, and I know Robin probably may not be familiar with this, we usually send a letter to the people who have stepped forward thanking them for volunteering and notifying them that they have been appointed. So.
And I would like to make a motion that we indeed send letters to those appointed to the boards and in expressing our thanks and appreciation for serving on our county boards.
Okay, do we have a second on that, Mark?
Sure, I'll second that. Robin's probably going to hate me for seconding it, but I will.
I know it's going to be a lot of letters. Sorry, Robin.
I'll be writing a lot of letters.
Well, get the body in. She'll.
Okay. So I'll call for a vote. Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
And Bergstrom is aye. Okay. We now have commissioners' reports. I have nothing particular to report. Do we have anything from my fellow commissioners?
If Sheila doesn't have anything, I'm happy to jump in here.
Okay. Please.
I just want to give a shout out to Shannon Hulst at the Cooperative Extension for helping pull together this forum that we did on last Wednesday. This was a forum on providing information to municipal officials and Cape residents on the various assistance programs that are available to aid homeowners who may be in particularly vulnerable property and may be interested in considering a buyout. This was basically designed to provide information to people who have asked us for information. It was well attended. We had over 150 people sign up. We had terrific representation from a number of federal and state partners. I certainly came away from the workshop much more informed as to how these programs will work, the potential county role down the road, and the challenges that homeowners will face if in the event they want to do this. And you know, I made the mistake of listening to a talk radio discussion about this, and it was sort of misrepresented as somehow an effort by the county to sort of create a new initiative. And it's really more intended to create an awareness of programs that exist. I do think it's important for us as a board to whenever it's appropriate to make people aware of resources that are available to them that can help them. I don't think we need to necessarily judge whether or not the help they're seeking for is appropriate or not, but those are their decisions. Our best role is to let people know that if there are programs that are out there that they think can help them, to get that information out. So I thought Shannon did a great job. The partners were terrific. And so for my report, it's just a shout out to Shannon for her outstanding job in organizing this. She's a terrific resource for us in the county. I know she's probably, with the work that she's done, saved homeowners thousands of dollars, and she's more than paid for herself in terms of her services. But I think this is just another example of a very, very important area of public policy and programs that it's great to have someone on our team that's well-versed on these kinds of programs and resources, because I do believe we're going to need to do more in this area down the road. So that's my report.
Okay. Yeah, Sheila?
Yes, I'm not sure if my hand is raised. I try to raise it. But first of all, I want to apologize for not being able to log on to that. I happened to be out of my home, and I had my device with me, but it just could not get in there. So I really regretted it, because I wanted to hear what that presentation was about and what are the options, because it really does impact the Cape and many residents on the Cape. I can only imagine what you were listening to on the radio. But I would love it. Was that presentation recorded? Can it be replicated? Because, you know, out in the Outer Cape, we have the Cape Cod Forum. We have the Wealthy Community Forum. That would be a great place to showcase something like that, just for information for people on the Outer Cape, because we know, we feel it just like Sandwich does. We're shrinking every day. And what is going to happen? And I can upload pictures, and I should, to the Cape Cod Commission and our website of houses over time. I keep taking similar pictures of the same place where they're now hanging over, you know, cliffs and pipes coming out of the ground where houses existed. And all of that ultimately ends up in our water. And it is just more and more toxic materials that happen to be in homes that fall in the water going in. And we already have a city that was taken out by a tsunami wave, and it destroyed a nuclear power plant in our own cities here in Louisiana and in the southern states. So it's a very important topic. It's not something that we can make believe doesn't exist, and it's not being I think it's just a resource that people need to know that exists. So I thank you for putting it together, Mark, and I'm sorry that I wasn't able to attend, and I'd like to be able to be aware of a link to it.
I'll be happy to speak to Shannon to make sure that you get that. I know it was recorded because we want to be able to use it. One of the things that we didn't talk about in the forum, but it was something that I was asked about by a newspaper reporter, was some of the other motivations behind this. You know, what I've been trying to do is follow what other counties are doing in terms of creating tools to deal with climate change. There are other counties that have created in a very creative way. They've created volunteer buyout programs that have involved hundreds of people, willing property owners that are interested in having their property purchased. Now, there typically is a public benefit. What happens in many of these cases is that the property that is purchased can be converted or returned to an important wetlands habitat. It can become, you know, important shorebird area. It's not like the government's getting nothing. There's actually a value and a return. And those are characteristics or aspects of these problems that often get overlooked, that there's a buyout, but that the government or the entity buying the property doesn't get anything returned. Or there's a conclusion that's reached by some that we're just bailing out people for making bad property decisions. I mean, the reality is that, as you know, Commissioner Lyons, living in Wellfleet, there are people that have purchased property in places like Wellfleet that where they've had hundreds of feet between themselves and a cliff or an eroded area or even a wetlands, and those areas have changed. You know, I was involved in relocating lighthouses on the Lower Cape years ago, the Highland Light and the Nauset Light. And they're now even talking about relocating lighthouses in the future. So relocating property is in helping relocate that property is actually pretty much a tried and true strategy on Cape Cod. So, you know, this isn't new. This has been done for years, going back to when this place was first settled, people moving and relocating their property. In fact, I don't want to go too far down a rabbit hole here, but I remember in the early history of Provincetown, when I worked in the manager's office there, we had numerous homes that were actually on floats. And we had homes on the Lower Cape floated from portions of town. And and this even occurred in Chatham and in Ron's neighborhood. So moving, relocating property is not unusual. It's a tried and true strategy that people have used for years. And I think as other counties start getting more involved in this space, at the very least, it's good that we're going to be kind of keeping an eye on what others are doing and the tools that they're creating, because with climate change, obviously, this is going to become more and more of an issue in an area where we need to really be up to speed on. And like I said, I think we've got the right people here in the county to help us stay on top of this. So
I'm just going to add one other thing just to underline your point there, Mark, is here in Wellfleet, we used to have Billingsgate, which was an island off in Wellfleet Harbor. And today you can go around Wellfleet and you will see some blue signs that will say a Billingsgate house. And it was when it was moved to the mainland as Billingsgate was being washed away. You can go down to Marconi Beach and look at the National Seashore and where the towers, those antennas were that were our first cable communication across the Atlantic. That was 2 miles out. That doesn't exist anymore. That's how far out. So 2 miles in 100 years is gone. Right. And so people have to realize that it's either that or you're going to lose your house altogether. My issue is, where are we going to move them to? We have only a little bit of space
if
here.
I can just add, I think that becomes part of the challenge for the homeowner.
The challenge, yes.
There's sort of an equity issue here. You know, there are people that live in areas like that are very desirable, that are also vulnerable, that have means, they have the resources.
Right.
But we do have people, and when you look at, for example, the Herring River Restoration Project,
yes.
There are people in areas that will be affected there that are not rich, that are of modest means, and you know they shouldn't get left behind, you know, as the sea level rises. If there's a way to facilitate some way of helping them save their home and be at a safer place, and utilizing programs that already exist, I think that's to everyone's interest.
Right. You know? And there is, you know, a lot of people have come to that conclusion and have come to where the Herring River is, but there's a few people who just, you know, why me? And there's a bigger thing between, you know, each and every one of us. So that connects us all, but that's a whole other story. So, but I thank you again. And we might even think about using our local government TV and Cape Cod Media to put some of these things on there as far as information loops for people, if they're very good forums like that.
Mr. Chairman, if I could?
Yes.
So Shannon Hulst, floodplain specialist, deputy director of the Cape Cod Cooperative Extension, staff to this event. To the recording question, we do have it. We're just working on getting it up on the county YouTube channel. And once we do, then we'll send that out to all of the registrants. So everyone will get that recording. We also have all of the presentations and some follow-up information. If our presenters didn't have questions right then, or answers to questions right then, they followed up with me. So we have all of that information available. And there have been requests since for more information, more presentations, so we can use the recording, or we can either I can do a summary presentation, or we could even get the same federal agencies potentially to participate again. So we do have that available, and I'd just like to remind folks that we will continue to work on this both at the extension and with the Cape Cod Commission, with all of our coastal resiliency work. This is certainly part of what we do, and we will continue to keep an eye on it and to work on it together.
Okay, thank you.
I was on that webinar, and it was very, very well organized, and a lot of valuable information came out of it. Okay, we're under commissioners' reports. Nobody else. How about upcoming business? You have something for us next week, Beth, right? That's the schedule.
Yeah. Yep. What we had proposed for next week was to the expansion or modification of the septic loan program, an update.
Yes. Okay. Great. Thank you.
If my fellow commissioners have anything pressing, you can email me or Beth or Robin within, the next 24 hours, and we'll put it on there.
I think the timing of talking about the septic system loan fund is timely, because towns are going to town meeting,
yes,
making big decisions on wastewater projects. I was hoping in Yarmouth we'd be going to town meeting on a regional project, but that's going to be deferred to the fall. But I do know in other towns, particularly Mashpee is one of them, where this is an important topic. So I think it's timely. If there's some way we can announce or get ready to propose an adjustment in the program that makes it more available and less costly to residents, I think doing that, the sooner we can do that, the better. But obviously we know that work needs to be done. So I appreciate you, Beth, making this a priority and getting this in front of us quickly so that we can hopefully take some action. So yeah. Thank you.
I agree.
Okay. Do we have anything, Beth, do you have anything to report to us, or you or the staff?
Sure. Just really quickly, I want to use this as an opportunity to just kind of update the commissioners on some of the major things I've been working on over the past week. One, I've started working with staff and legal counsel to undertake a review of all of our standard contracts, agreements, MOU, bid docs. I just feel as a new administrator, I want to make sure we have new legal counsel that we have everything in tip-top shape. I'm also reviewing other policies, including the remote work policy, and we'll be working with staff and HR on that. Scheduling an open meeting law refresher in May, so that stay tuned for the date on that. It will be later in the month. And we continue to convene an internal ARPA work group. And at some point, we'll be able to, it's premature, and we're still waiting for guidance from Treasury on these funds, but we continue to work and plan internally. So I just wanted to give you that quick update. Thank you.
Else the staff? Yes, Elizabeth.
Good morning, Elizabeth Bracha, Finance Director. I just want to echo on what Beth is saying. We're also looking at our financial policy. We're going to be adding a few things to it and bringing that forward for approval to your board.
Thank you.
Elizabeth, just a quick question, Mr. Chairman, through you to Elizabeth. We made a request of the Department of Revenue back in February for them to assist us in reviewing our financial policies. I think everyone agreed that it was great to have a fresh set of eyes. Mm-hmm. They had offered. Did they accept, and are they participating in this? Is that process moving forward?
They didn't speak to me. I think Jack might have contacted them. Jack, do you know if they've responded to you on this?
They have not. I haven't heard anything as of yet, Beth.
Well, that's too bad, because I do think that I think what we're hoping for is, since they had expressed some interest in assisting us in reviewing our policies, mm-hmm. My hope is that we can somehow pursue that. We sent a letter in, I believe. I had drafted something. I think the commissioners approved it. This was back in February.
Right.
And I know that team is already up to their neck in reviewing Yarmouth's financial management practices.
And they have to go to Wellfleet.
Right. Yeah, they'll probably be on their way to Wellfleet sometime.
I know. Well, they'll be there over a year.
I didn't say that. But they're incredibly helpful. They're very talented. I'd love to see if we can, before we present something, get them engaged.
Well, I think we can send a letter and probably an email under the commissioner's headland directly to the Department of Revenue, reminding them of our request and asking them for a response at this point. So I think that's probably they're probably busy, like you say, seems to be one town after another, but we'll reconnect with them and see if we can get some information out of them. Jack, you're online. Jack, when is your official capacity with the county end?
Friday p.m.
What's that?
Friday
at 5 p.m. So I'm sorry that we were going to have a party at the Hilton for you, but unfortunately, the COVID restrictions, we weren't able to do that. But I'm sure that the county and our staff and certainly our commissioners and maybe even some of our past commissioners can get together and have some formal appreciation for the work that you've done over these many years. You came into a county that was, say the least, in sort of flux and maybe in disarray, and you're leaving when we're in as good shape as it has been, I think, in the history of the county. So I'm certainly appreciative, and I know that I can speak for the people that you've worked with and the people who work for you, that you've done a great job. I know you're still going to be in Dennis, so they get phone calls from time to time from us, trying to get some historical knowledge of what's going on. Like, for instance, with the I think recently with the CVEC and its where that kind of stuff is. But we really appreciate what you've done, and you've made a big difference, not only in the county, but in the lives of the people who receive services from the county. So thank you very much. And
I appreciate that. One little item of business. I'll make sure that I dig out that letter to DOR, and we'll send, Beth and I can send a joint letter to them, and I can introduce Beth as the new administrator. So we'll keep that alive that way.
Okay.
As it relates to what you just said, Ron, Casey Stengel was once asked what makes a good manager, and his response was good players. Believe me, it's all the success of this county is due to the tremendous, tremendous people that work for it. And the elected officials that really do passionately care for county government. So it's the credit goes to all. Thank you so much for saying that. It's a huge team effort.
Well, I just want to say that I was there when we hired Jack, and Jack did bring in a cult. He improved the culture that was existing there. And for a long time, we did really good things in spite of ourselves. But there was a period there where, a lot of different different interests came in. And Jack really came in as an adult. And I think people really appreciated that someone was in charge. Someone was supportive, someone was going to have their back and get through whatever mess they felt that they might be heading into, and we're going to do it, and we're going to get it done, we'll fix it, and we're going to get better. And I think the staff really, really needed that back then, and I thank you for bringing that to the county.
And I think we're in real good shape.
I think we're in real
good shape. I've got all the confidence in the world in our leaders, so...
Okay.
I was kind of disappointed when I found out there was actually one senator from the western part of the state that Jack did not have a personal relationship with. So I quickly remedied that And now he knows everybody who's ever been elected anything here in any Massachusetts. So, Elizabeth, did you have something to add to this?
I didn't. My hand's still up. I'm sorry about that. But I would like to thank Jack for everything. It's been great working with you. You brought me in a couple of years ago, and I have learned a lot. And I'm very happy to be here and sad to see you go. But Beth, I'm also happy to be working with you, so it's kind of a double-edged sword for me.
Well, you know, one generation passes, makes way for the next, and that's how life is. So,
yes. Elizabeth, you and Beth are going to make great partners, believe me.
Okay.
I do.
On the issue of connections, Ron, I'll tell you one funny story. The first time I presented the retirement bill to the State House, we had to go into a hearing at A&F. And on the way out, I was coming down Mass Ave. I think Steve Tebow was driving, and I forget who else was in the car. And by the hospital, we was a homeless person came up and knocked at the window with his cup. And I rolled down the window, and he said, "Hey, aren't you the mayor of Brockton?" Well, they were pretty aghast because they had seen all the people I knew in the building, and they didn't know I knew the homeless on Mass Ave.
If I could just say,
can't be shy.
That was my favorite Jack story.
Jack, let me just say a word. You can see all folks are putting thumbs up and applause signs on their screens. But you know, I think you know I learned this a long time ago that if you don't care about who gets credit for anything, and you're happy to share that. It's amazing how much you can get accomplished. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's just one lesson that we learn in this business. But, I mean, you've been, I think, as a leader, you've been mentoring our department heads now for so many years that obviously they've picked up so much from you and they've learned so much. I think the strength of this county is when you look at it, it's the strength in our personnel. It's the strength in our departments.
Okay.
Yeah, as you've said, they do some incredible work. Look at how well this county has risen to the challenge in terms of dealing with this pandemic and the coronavirus. I can't tell you how many times I get calls or messages from people thanking the county, thanking us for the work that is going on out there. So when you look at the way in which we've performed in a time of crisis, when you look at the way in which the county stood up time and time again, you know, you should take great pride in your legacy, because your legacy is a living legacy. You'll see the evidence of it every day in the work that goes on in this county complex, in this campus, and among the people that are delivering these services. They're doing a fantastic job. And a lot of it has to do with their service with a fantastic leader who's really helped them grow and develop and become really top performers in the work that they do. So there's a lot to be proud of here, Jack. I'm proud that I've had the opportunity to work with you in a variety of capacities back when you were mayor and obviously in the county. And I've like my other fellow board members, I've enjoyed it immensely, and we're going to miss you. We know you're in Dennis, but we are going to miss you, and we'll be trying to keep in touch in the days ahead. So God bless you, and thank you, and good luck to you.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, when we get a chance, we'll share a socially distant beer with you, some we'll all get together. But well, all right.
I think Christina has somebody has their hand up there, Ron.
Yes. Go ahead. You're on.
Good morning. I just wanted to make sure that I didn't misunderstand that Jack stated that his last day was this Friday, the 30th.
Yes.
I believe, my dear Jack, that your contract says May 5th.
Oh, okay.
It's next Wednesday.
Oh, so we can do this again.
Yeah.
We can say all these nice things again.
Hey, let me say this.
That way.
One thing, Beth, that you'll always have is a great firewall with Justina. She's the best.
I also want to add that I believe I was in that car and I believe that I was leaving the State House with you, and we couldn't even get through the hallway without everybody talking to Jack. It was an extra hour just because everyone wanted to talk to Jack.
Well, with that, we only have one more item left on our agenda today. Item 12.
Yes.
I'd like to move that we adjourn, Mr. Chairman.
And I will second that.
Okay, it's moved and seconded. I'll call for a vote. Commissioner Lyons.
Aye.
Commissioner Forrest.
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. And so it's a wrap. And we will
see. Thank you, everybody. Thanks for everything you're doing.
Including perhaps our past administrator. He'll be lingering on.
Yes, that's right. He's not, we can't be like a.
I said, with,